Damn chicken. Damn chicken. Damn chicken. Rocking it in the flower pot.
From Innovation Park, it's After Hours. With your host, Jordan Tracy and Chloe Cohen. Tonight on After Hours, President of the Social Justice Coalition, Ryan Davis. And a special visit from Donald Trump and DJ Khaled. Now here's your host, Jordan Tracy, back at it again with the white vans. Hey!
That's what I feel like the music should be when I enter. Why not? So, welcome to After Hours, everybody. I'm your host, Jordan Tracy, and alongside me, as recently always, and by recently always, I mean the entire year now, because it's not recent anymore, Chloe Cohen!
I'm just an old washed-up hag at this point.
Yep, old washed-up
I've worked hard to be here, though.
Yeah. Do you, boo.
Thanks, boo.
So, we've been gone for a little while, so we have to kind of update you on some of the things that were happening. So, while we were away, some scary things started happening. Businessman and resident Fur Orange, which is I like to call him a fur orange, Donald Trump has won the primaries, as you can see. Look at that little furry orange. Orange, furry, weatherman. He won the primaries in New Hampshire and Nevada. This caused us to elevate our President Trump threat level from a code yellow orange to blood orange.
Sexy.
Yes.
Girls,
we are on alert. This girls, could be happening.
Like, girls at State College look like that sometimes.
Yeah, yeah.
Like, I'm realizing that now. Like, this is what people pay to look like.
He looks, yeah, definitely looks like that one girl in your class that always lost her voice.
Yeah. She was, like, super raspy, yeah. And you're like,
sorry, I lost my voice, professor. And it's like, this is, like, week 7, and you still haven't had a voice yet. What have you been doing? I lost it.
You
that
know.
Girl's the worst. Anyway, SeaWorld was caught spying on their competitors last week by posing as animal rights activists. A little weird. Which is the closest they've ever gotten to caring about their animals. Ooh, political jokes about fish and stuff. Free Willy in that whole situation. It's all politics, really is. So Fuller House is a spinoff of the popular 90s sitcom Full House, and it just came out last week on Netflix. But I think everyone was surprised by Netflix's take on the show. Take a look at this. Hearts of cards. Yikes. A lot of politics going on in there.
Within the household.
Within the household. Yeah, Michelle's not there. Vacuum of power. Yeah. Never mind. I was going to say kind of like a certain country, but we'll move on. Facebook owner and creator Mark Zuckerberg is now embracing the live video built into the Facebook news feeds, saying, "Live video is one of the things I am most excited about because it's so raw and so visceral." Yeah, visceral. That's it.
Hey everyone, how's it going? Oh. We are live from behind the scenes in Barcelona.
Oh, and what's going on, everybody?
So raw.
We're back.
So visceral.
So raw. The show.
So as I said, I'm only going until 2 today.
Okay,
guys.
Catching
disease.
I understand. Right, there's another
so I can
one.
Say goodbye.
Another live one. Again.
I'll check you guys out later. I'm gonna go nap because I'm really tired.
Shield your eyes. Is there more?
All right,
oh no, that's Mark Zuckerberg again. Okay, I like the live video. hate you guys. Every single one of you.
So real.
So raw. So visceral. Anyway, screw you guys. The UN, I can't even get over that. I hate all of you so much. Moving along, the UN experienced technical difficulties while attempting to deliver food for Syrian civilians. It looks like Syria also uses OrderUp, or any delivery system in your region. It's all the same. It really is.
True.
It's all the same.
They're all late. They all disappoint. And I don't know why the pizza crust is always cold.
Always.
Always.
Just the crust part.
Just the
Everything
crust.
Everything else is lava.
Everything
hot.
Else is really gooey. And like my crust is always cold.
Yeah.
That's I should really file a complaint. I think they're doing something.
Yeah.
It's like 402.
Especially when it comes from insomnia. It's crust on the outside.
It's really hard to break into it.
It's real static. A unicorn.
Okay. So.
Is this a unicorn or what's going on?
It's not a real unicorn. It's a girl who must love unicorns because she has a pony that she put a horn on prosthetically.
So it's a horny pony with a prosthetic.
And it's on the loose.
And it's on the loose.
It's on the loose.
That's not what it is?
That's
Pony's
exact.
Not horny? That's... And it's on the loose, on the prowl?
No,
Fair
that's
enough.
Exactly what it is.
Okay, so a horny pony led California Highway Patrol officers on a four-hour chase. I sound like a raspy girl.
Anyway. Yeah. Raspy.
I'm sorry, I lost my voice. I was
chasing
my
yellow. I was on a
chase. Oh, chase.
Being chased. By horny pony.
Horny pony. Came to the fat house. Sorry. Well, little tangent there. I apologize, friends.
Back to unicorn.
Back to the horny pony. 4-hour chase last week, but she was finally found and returned to her 5-year-old owner, Tatum. And after the incident, Juliet, the unicorn, was quoted saying, "Please let me die already. My existence is pain." That's sad. That's not magical whatsoever.
There's nothing magical about that.
No, not at all. We have a great show for you this week. President of the Social Justice Coalition, Brian Davis, is here. We won't be talking about horny ponies.
I was about to say, we timed that poorly. Yeah. With the existence is pain.
Here we go. It's a great show. Stick around, and we'll be right back after this. Don't go away. Woo! Welcome back to After Hours. Our guest this week is the president of the Social Justice Coalition, and his name is Brian Davis. Welcome, Brian Davis.
Thanks for having me.
Yeah, man. Thanks for coming. We really appreciate it. We're going to talk about something really cool that he was able to do with the coalition. But first, just give us a brief explanation of what the group does and what they're about.
Cool. So the Social Justice Coalition is basically an organization that was comprised of over 60 different student organizations on campus. And not only did we come together bi-weekly to talk about issues in the community, we also are an organization that's all about activism and unity amongst the Penn State undergraduate students. So anything that we see that we need to be hands-on with, that we can go to another community and create some type of change, we're all for it. So
recently you actually traveled to something that's been in the news recently, maybe not as much as it should be, but you actually took a trip to Flint, Michigan and organized that whole thing.
Yeah.
So talk a little bit about organizing and what you guys ended up doing.
Cool. So it all started with me just scrolling my phone on Twitter, and I saw a hashtag that said Flint Water Crisis. And basically when I went through the hashtag, the first thing I saw was some brown water, and I was like, you know what? I gotta get more involved with this. Let me do some research. And then I started to realize that it was set up this way. You know, it was a form of environmental racism, you know. So I talked to a few friends and I said, you know what? Let's ship them some water, you know. So then we made a flyer, we started collecting water in the PRCC. We are an affiliate organization of the PRCC. And then from there, word spread, because I'm in multiple organizations, so the word, it wasn't hard to get propagated amongst the campus. And then what we decided to do was, you know, if we're going to be an activism organization, we can't just send water. We have to go there as well. So we did both. So,
what was the kind of response that you got at first when you decided to start this drive?
Oh, man, you should see my Yik Yak account, man. They was like, why are we sending water to Flint, Michigan? We don't care about them. And then on the other hand, you have, yo, this is a great cause. You know, how do I get involved? Can we set up different locations on campus, mm-hmm. like in East Commons, West Commons, all those different places? But I thought that the PRCC would be the best location to do that. And then once I reached out to the Muslim Student Association, they brought about 7 carloads of water to the PRCC. And then from there, just skyrocketed. And then we got so much water that we didn't have to collect monetary funds, because at first we just was collecting the water, and then we thought, you know, the university may just help us out with shipping it, and then we refrained from that, and then we just started collecting monetary funds for a week.
So you said, and we were talking a little bit before the show, that you kind of had a little bit of an issue of funds at first, mm-hmm. Because Penn State, with the budget, wasn't able to fund you guys.
Right.
So how did you start raising funds? Did you just add the fact like, oh, we're taking money too, or did you have to reach out to different groups?
Yeah, so all I did was on a flyer was add collecting monetary funds and water. And from there, you know, I was annoying a lot of people on Yik Yak. They was like, yo, you just posted this 10 times. And I'm just like, we got to get this out here, you know? And then I'm familiar with a lot of faculty members, so I got the flyer put on a lot of different listservs, and I'm in a lot of group meets as well. And then I had a lot of students just, you know, sharing information and really just reaching out. And then from there, we started collecting so much money. And then a few members from the African American Studies Department, they reached out to me as well, and they said, you know, we're willing to help, whether it's for reservations, hotel, gas, anything. So we need to help with the U-Haul the most. And then they brought forward about all the money that we needed for U-Haul and gas, so it was great.
And you said you got like donations from everywhere, right? Like international donations came in, right?
Yes, yeah. We received some donations from Syria as well as Jamaica as well, so.
That's awesome.
That's awesome, because yeah. I mean, like Syria has their own problems, as a lot of people know, and they were able to reach out and help the cause here.
Yep.
So talk about a little bit of the journey, because so you've collected all this stuff, and now you're heading to Flint, Michigan. What's going through your mind when you're, what is it, like a 6-hour drive that you said ended up taking 8?
Yeah, so basically we left campus around, I want to say about 3:30, 4 o'clock. And, you know, as we getting in the car, we like, yo, we think this is going to be a long ride, you know? So when we stopped in Cleveland, Ohio, and I didn't even know where we was at until I saw all the Cavaliers signs everywhere. So,
once you see LeBron, because I mean, Cleveland is like 99% LeBron. Mm-hmm. There's nothing else in Cleveland but like smog and LeBron.
Yep, exactly.
Good combo though.
Yeah. And then we stopped there, and then we drove to Flint, Michigan. So as we are approaching Flint, I noticed all of these American flags, and I was like, how do I see all these flags, and I don't see no justice here, you know? So the closer we get into Flint, we drove through Detroit, and then we get in, and we saw a fire just on the highway for some. It was just a random fire.
What?
Yeah.
Happens, I guess.
Wait, like, are we talking like there's like a little tree on fire? It's like, oh no,
we're talking about
just like 14 cars and a giant like explosion.
We talking about
Vin Diesel walking out of it. Like, I did this.
Right. Yeah. It was more of a like a fire. You know, the borders that separate traffic that's going that way, yeah, that was on fire for some reason.
You know, they're just having pyrotechnics in Detroit, yeah. Walking you guys.
So, it was too cool, apparently, to put out. They were like, we're not going to extinguish this. Just keep it going.
Right, yeah. So when we got to the, we finally got there about 12 a.m., and we stayed at a motel, Super 8. It was, I don't even want to talk about that. It was really bad.
We'll skip over that.
Yeah, we got
to. You guys are like dead hookers.
Yeah. It was, so when we first walked in the motel, the first thing I asked was, is the water okay?
I mean, that's a very important question.
Exactly. And she said it was, but when we turned on, like, we had 5 rooms. Certain people, like, water was, like, all this black stuff was coming out, and certain people, water was not clear. I was like, you know what? I guess I really have to empathize with the residents at Flint and what they're going through. Mm-hmm. So when I got washed at the sink, and every time I wanted to like you know, put some water in my washcloth, I was like, I can't even do it, you know. So it took me about 8 bottles of water just to wash my body about 2 times. And then it took me about a bottle and a half to brush my teeth. And I was just like, I can't even imagine how it would take a family of 7, you know, how much water that is, you know. And then
that's every day.
Every day, yeah. And then we gotta cook, clean, all those other things too that we don't even take into consideration. And after that, we ate breakfast in the morning. The breakfast, it was pretty bad too.
And shout out to Super 8. Can't wait for you guys to sponsor us.
And so after that, I called the guy that we were, the organization that he was working with. He works with a lot of undocumented families and a lot of churches. So we met with the staff member that was kind enough to drive the water down there. We met up with her. We unloaded all of the water at the church, the first church, St. Mary's Church. And as we were dumping the water, a few family members, undocumented people, are driving up. You see a lot of Mexican people, a lot of white people, a lot of black people, a lot of Indian people. So it's not just, it was a community of color that was directly affected, but you also have different race groups that were all coming out because they were affected as well. So after we dumped the water off there, you know, take a few pictures, talking to the residents there and talking about how everything is going. And then the guy that I was working with, he called me, he said, you know what, let's get started. Let's start delivering this water out to these families. So we had a university van that held 15 people in 2 different cars. And then we drove to St. Michael's Catholic Church about, let's say, 10 minutes down the road. And then from there, he said, he gave us a list of 40 addresses and homes with phone numbers. And he said before, like, he gave us the rundown about, you know, how to approach them, because a lot of them are scared. A lot of them think that we are the government, that we're coming to take them. And to side note that, the people who don't have documentation, they don't get aid, they don't get water from the government. So that's why we came up there. So basically, we got the list, and we divided into teams. We had 3 teams. Each team had 13, one had 14. And we called the homes. A lot of them didn't answer because I'm guessing it may have been the area code of our number, or they just was scared, you know. So after that, we just started, you know, delivering to families, and then hearing different stories, and then seeing, you know, sinks full of dishes, seeing brown water, seeing a dilapidated community, all of those things. So it was a crazy experience.
Yeah, and Brian, we actually want you to stick around. We're going to split this in two here. So we'll be right back with Brian Davis. Welcome back, everybody. We still have Brian Davis here, president of the Social Justice Coalition, and we're talking about his trip to Flint, Michigan. So, Brian, you were talking about, you know, some of the things that you experienced, some of the families. You were giving water to, you know, the undocumented, and the need is just more of a community thing rather than just a race thing.
Right.
And you know, to have to realize that it affects all of us and not just, it's affecting the whole community down there. So what are some of the things that you saw being down there and helping out?
Cool. So the first thing that I noticed, I live in Philadelphia, and I know where the destroyed communities look like, but those communities in Philadelphia may look like the suburbs compared to Flint, and I think that is crazy, you know. And some blocks, like when we were doing certain deliveries, certain blocks only had 3 houses on a block. Everything else was burned down. And as we were driving around, because we were going from the east side of Flint to the west side of Flint, all of these different places, I didn't see, only stores we saw were liquor stores. We didn't see any food stores, any convenience stores, no supermarkets, nothing. You know what I mean? And that was crazy to me. And as we were driving, we started to get hungry. So we stopped, and we wanted to go to, they had a Raleigh's there. And as I was on the phone, I was calling my mom, just, you know, tell her about the trip and everything. I see all this smoke. I was like, oh, wow, right? So I'm not paying any mind. It might be just smoke. And then I turn around, and the whole Raleigh's is on fire.
Jeez. One place to eat. Only, on yeah. five.
So yeah, we had to just eat like granola bars and bananas and stuff. Wow. So as we're making our deliveries, we see a lot of houses were boarded up and burnt down. So this one specific trip we had to make was to the addresses were 2213 and 2215. So 2213, they got 10 cases of water. I'm not sure how big the family size was, but we had to deliver 10 cases. And as we're talking to them, you know, we're asking them, how's everything going? They just, you know, we just don't know what to do. You know, we're running out of options. We don't have help. And we just, you know, sitting there building with them and talking to them. And I had to guess, because that's the odd side of the street, that 2215 would be the next house. But when we looked to the left, it was no more houses on the block. And it was enough space for about 12 more houses right there. So we asked him, we was like, do you guys know where 2215 is at? He was like, yeah, it should be right there. The only thing we saw was a stove there.
No walls.
Nothing, just a stove in the middle of the grass. And I'm just like, this is crazy, you know? And then another thing that we saw when we went to our last trip was, it was a family of three. It was a mother, a daughter, and her son. And when we walked in, the son, he ran up so happy to us, Mom, we have company. And that's where it started for me, because as a child, like, he was so happy to see us, but I don't even think he understood what type of crisis that he's living through, mm-hmm. you know? And to see him happy in a time like this kind of broke me down a little bit. And then when we brought the water in the house, she said, yeah, just put it in the kitchen. So when we went in the kitchen, I seen a sink full of dishes, right? So I'm like, wow, this water thing is really bad. But then when I look on the left side of the sink, it was a sink, it was all full of dishes. And on the right side, it was all brown water. And I was like, oh, I gotta go. I almost passed out. It was really bad. And then the family in there, they didn't even have any clothes. They had just had blankets on, because they must have washed their clothes in the water as well. Jeez. And a lot of families too, they were really scared. When we were walking up, like certain people was just, thank you, have a good day. And some really wanted to talk about the situation, you know, mm-hmm. So
how did this match, you know, your expectations going in? Like, did it match anything that you were expecting, or did you see things that you just couldn't even fathom?
I saw things I couldn't even fathom. I didn't even think that I would ever see a city that only had three houses on one block. And three houses on the next block, and five on the next block. You can see the whole neighborhood just on one block, because it's so many houses missing that you can probably just run through the whole thing. And I was just like, and that's the thing. When we were driving up there, that's the only thing we were talking about. Yo, what is it gonna look like? What is it gonna look like? And when we got there, we were just like, as soon as we got into Flint, we just taking pictures. Everybody's taking pictures, mm-hmm. because we never seen anything like this before, you know? Coming from the communities that we come from, we thought that was the worst until we got to Flint, so.
Do you start now, like when you do normal, ordinary things, think about like how much water you're using now?
Yes, definitely. Every time I look at the faucet, I think about when I was in Flint and I was deprived of using the faucet to, you know, drink water, to wash my hands, anything like that. And it really goes to show that, like, when you have a heart, those things like come, they know, you notice those things, you know?
Mm-hmm. Wow. Well, Brian, I want to thank you for coming on. This is definitely something we want to get out there and share, and these experiences. And you guys said you're actually thinking about taking another trip down there.
Yes, we definitely want to take a trip down there, because those conversations that we had with those families, it's not just one conversation, you know? We want to have multiple. We want to really be there for them, as well as creating this documentary that we're thinking about doing as well, so.
All right, so a documentary, another trip. Brian, thank you very much. You just hear these things. You hear the news, but someone actually went down there and saw it. So when you start spreading the word, definitely contact us. We'll help you spread the word. Thank you, everybody, to Brian Davis for joining by. And we have more After Hours after the break. Don't go away.
Thanks.
That's funny.
Welcome back to After Hours. So, Jordan.
Yes, my friend.
How's everything been going? How's your life?
You know, I'm sad.
Why are you sad?
Because I'm a little nervous.
Oh,
I got this
nervous?
Trump stamp.
Oh.
It's where you put a tattoo of Trump right above your butt crack.
What's his like facial expression when he's like, oh.
It's like a double anus.
I was about to say, it's like you almost like have two buttholes.
Yeah, you know, you just put an ass on the top of your ass, and that's a Trump stamp.
Speaking of which, we actually have, Trump came by the studio, so we have that footage. You can check it out.
Welcome back to After Hours. Thank you guys for joining us. We've got a special treat for you tonight. I'm sitting down here fresh off his campaign, Mr. Donald Trump.
Hey, Matt, how are you? Great to be here.
I'm doing well. Thanks for joining us. So I hear you're not here to promote your presidency, but you are here to promote your new line of vacation resorts.
Well, first of all, let me say I've been on the campaign trail. It's been a lot of fun, guys. I've had a lot of fun. But I'm here today for a different reason. I've got a new line of resorts. You want to hear about them?
I want it.
They
want
to hear about it. Come on.
Come on, guys. You guys want to hear it?
Yeah.
So what do we got to look forward to with these new resorts?
Okay, Matt, you know I have tremendous respect for you. Great guy. Unfortunately, we got a lot of people in this country, total losers. They're no good. They're here illegally. So what a better thing to do than to give these guys a nice resort. How about North America? All right, we'll put it somewhere in North America.
Okay.
A great resort. It'll be warm. It'll be very warm.
Very warm.
You'll love it. Great women.
So it's where specifically in North America, where it's somewhere warm?
Well, it's south.
South of where?
It's a little bit further south than Texas.
So Mexico.
Well, yeah, I mean.
So we're sending undocumented workers to Mexico.
Well, yeah, we're going to send them down there. They're going to love it, by the way. They're going to love this resort.
You sure they're going to love it?
Oh, yeah.
What are these real resorts?
These are real resorts. The people, they're going to love it so much, they're going to want to stay there forever.
But yeah, Mr. Trump, it sounds a little bit like you're trying to trick undocumented workers into being deported to Mexico.
Let me tell you something, Matt. The only tricks being played are the liberal media telling us that we can't win this election. Let me tell you something.
You weren't here to talk about your election, right?
Well, now you gave me a loaded question Megyn Kelly. Come on. I had more respect for you than that.
All right. That's enough. Thank you, Mr. Trump.
No, we're going to talk about the border. We're going to build a wall.
Thank you, Mr.
It's
Trump.
It's going to be a big wall. We'll have a big, beautiful gate.
And we'll be right back.
Welcome back to After Hours, the show where shenanigans happen shenanigans.
So true. Right? Truer statement has never been said.
Yeah, I feel like sometimes we're like in a reverse universe and it's just like, what?
I was wondering if I was the only
Sorry,
one that St. felt that
Patty's
way.
Is still wearing off.
I stayed in my dorm, but I still felt that reverse universe thing.
Me too. I'm just trying to look cool to everyone else. I went out so hard, guys. I watched Seinfeld and fell asleep at midnight.
That's a pretty late night.
The bars were nuts. Drank my face off, 14 beers. I was shirtless at one point. I was like, what?
Probably after beer three.
After beer three, I'm a lightweight. I died
with the tendency to just take your shirt off anyway.
Yeah, you know, I like to take my shirt off, like Matthew McConaughey does. Yeah.
All right.
So what we got for you, and the reason why we're talking, is because Shane has some good advice for you. and it's in the style of the great philosopher DJ Khaled. So take a look, and maybe after you watch it, you'll want another one.
We the best. You a genius. I appreciate you. Brush your teeth twice a day and floss. You smart. You very smart. You loyal. Don't leave the toilet seat up. All doors is open if you unlock them with the keys to success. I went to the supermarket and I bought sour cream and onion chips. and I took my groceries from the bag, and I took them and I put them in the grocer's hands. In his hands. His hands. And you can too. Win, 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 no matter what. Don't let them tell you you can't. Use club soda to get those stains out your clothes if you've got a stain. A stain. Put some money in your savings account. Buy your mama a house. Buy your whole family houses. Get licensed and teach a Sunday Zumba class from 10 to 11 a.m. This part of the video right here is for when you're doing sit-ups or push-ups, Kegel exercises, studying for finals, chin-ups, laundry, vaping, running through a meadow with the love of your life, eating a taco, shopping for some jewelry for your girlfriend, spooning, competitive badminton, whatever. Let's get it. Another one. Another one. Another one. Another one. And another one. And another one.
Everybody, welcome back to After Hours, but unfortunately what I'm doing is opening you to the close.
Aww.
Aww. You know, we always open at the close and close at the open. More you're reverse like, universe than yes. I don't know what I'm on.
I was about to say, you're like Dumbledore in this situation.
I feel like
which
Dumbledore.
Would make me Harry Potter or Snape. Yeah. Take your pick.
Let's say Snape. In honor of
Alan Rickman.
Alan Rickman.
The day he died, I walked around for a solid 24 hours in a British accent just to see how people would react. They didn't react well, though. Mm-hmm. They were like kind of like just peeved.
You know that Alan Rickman played a German in Die Hard and just did his normal accent? If you watch Die Hard at the beginning, like it's trying to be German, and then by the middle, he's like, I'm Alan Rickman, I don't care.
I'm Alan Rickman. It probably wasn't care. Even a good accent.
No, it's probably not bad at all.
It's British.
It's British. They're all the same.
Everyone picks it up.
They're literally all the same. Anyway, so if they want to hear more ramblings about Alan Rickman, where can they find us on the YouTube?
On the YouTube, you can find us at After Hours at PSNtv.
And then if they want to find us and see what we're talking about, like damn, Jordan, rocking the white Vans. Where can they find that on the Twitter bird?
On your
Facebook. You guys
Facebook.
Don't like that? You guys don't like that Vine?
No.
I like it. But damn, Daniel.
After Hours, PSNtv.
Yeah.
Again.
How about the
like quiz.
Instagram-gram? They want to see us in sepia.
After Hours, PSNtv.
Okay, and then if they want to find us on Tumblr, quick question, we don't have a Tumblr.
We should totally make one.
Yeah, just
with all the good footage.
Just make GIFs of me going, whoa, like back.
And just ones of me just sitting here like this.
I don't know what situation I'd ever do this move. Maybe if we're at the aquatic club.
Ooh.
Is there an aquatic club?
Yeah, let's contact them.
Yeah. So check us out next week where we'll interview the aquatic club. And thank you for joining us, and we'll see you next week. Couple weeks from now, who cares? We'll see.
I'll be here.
All right, cutting it short so I can say goodbye.
I'll check you guys out later. I'm gonna go nap because I'm really tired.